Hi everybody, my name is Rupa, working as assistant professor in Chebrol Engineering College in the Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering and dealing the subject renewable energy sources. And today's topic is semiconductor junctions. Now coming to the semiconductor junctions, so we will see now what are the different types of junctions the electrons will be, electrons and holes making. So for various materials, there are different types of junctions. We will see all now. In modern solar cells, we are using semiconductor materials. So these semiconductor materials are usually based on single crystal silicon. So what we are using this single crystal silicon, it is the most common. Single crystal silicon is the most common used semiconductor materials. So if you are taking this single crystal silicon and we are comparing, we are taking this silicon and we are bonding this silicon with various semiconductor materials, and what are the characteristics of that bonding we will see now. So suppose first, if a silicon is doped with phosphorus or arsenic or antimony, okay, so first, at first stage, if the silicon is doped with what are the three semiconductor materials? Phosphorus, arsenic and antimony. So if the silicon is doped with these three types, silicon will be becoming a n-type semiconductor. Okay, these all are I discussed early how the n-type and p-type are formed. So by these three, n-type semiconductor are formed. Okay, and if at all this silicon is doped with boron, aluminium, indium or gallium, it forms a p-type semiconductor. Suppose if this p-type semiconductor is brought into a contact with the n-type, then p-n junction or n-p junctions will be formed. If the two materials are derived from the same element, okay, so suppose if doped elements, what we are doping, if the two elements are doped with the same elements, that means if we are doping two same elements, then our compounds, such as suppose we, if you take silicon, if silicon is doped on silicon, then we are deriving a form called homojunction, right? So the junction formed due to doping of two same elements or compounds is called homojunction. This homojunction, it is also possible for PN or NP junctions, okay, or we can form PN or NP junctions with two different semiconductor materials. Suppose if you use cadmium sulfide CDS, right, and copper sulfide Cu2S, this junction is called as heterojunction. I explained in before figure the generalized behavior at the junction above. Okay, so these above junctions are explained detailed in the before slides. Fermi level, n-type material, flow of electrons, photons, holes, right? Next, one of the important junction is Schottky junction. This Schottky junction means it consists of a metal and semiconductors. Okay, so this junction is also formed by depositing a thin layer of metallic conductor. If you take a thin layer of metallic conductor, for example platinum, okay, so if you take thin layer of platinum and if you dope on to p or n type semiconductor, then this Schottky junction will be formed. This Schottky junction, in this Schottky junction, photovoltaic cells will be made of amorphous silicon. Okay, photovoltaic cells are made of amorphous silicon. Because these amorphous silicon, it is most efficient than homo junction, that is formed by PN cells of same material. Okay, so by instead of making a PN junction, if you make a Schottky junction, it will be more efficiently working because only a thin layer of amorphous is to the semiconductor junctions. So how are the net current J, it is given by to the semiconductor junctions. So how are the net current J, see here we can see what is the conversion efficiency and output. So before, oh, 1 minute. Now coming to the semiconductor junctions, so we will see now. What are the different types? See, if under material is there, I said Schottky junction to other material, MIS is there, MIS. This is a metal. This is called as MIS. This is metal insulated semiconductor. It is modern type of solar cell and it is similar to the Schottky junction only. But there is only some difference called in MIS, there will be a thin layer, very very thin layer of about 0.1 to 0.3 micrometers of insulator is deposited between the semiconductors and the metallic conductors. Okay, so this conversion this is also having conversion efficiency of more than 17% of normal single crystal silicon. Suppose if the single crystal silicon is having a percentage conversion efficiency of 20%, if you take for example, this MIS is having more than 20%, that is more than 17% means it is around having 37% total of conversion efficiency. Now we will see the conversion efficiency and power output. To the semiconductor junctions. So how are the so these are the next conversion efficiencies and power outputs. Actually, a solar cell is usually, it uses a PN junction. Okay, its physical configuration is shown in before slides figure. That PN junction is, we are taking this PN junction and we are drawing the equivalent circuit of a solar cell. The current and voltage relationships are given by Ji is equal to J naught expressed exponential VE by KT minus 1. Here J naught is the, it is called saturation current, also the dark current, and it is obtained when large negative voltage is applied across the diodes. So when a large negative voltage is applied across the diodes, it is coming. This is called saturation current. And next term is V. V is the voltage across the junction. Here capital V is the voltage across the junction. And small e, it represents electronic charge. And K, here K is called as Boltzmann constant. And T is the absolute temperature. So if you are giving, if you are putting some light on the junction, that means impinges some light on the junction, electrons hole spaces are created at constant rates. Okay, so until you put the light on the junction, up to that time electron hole pairs will be creating. So these are created at constant rates, providing an electrical current flow across the junctions. Okay, so this electron hole pairs, these provide electrical current flow across the junction. And the net current is, example, the net current, how to calculate, means it is the difference between normal diode current and light generated current JL. Okay, so what is that? It is the difference between normal diode current JA and the light generated current JL. This is the net current that is flowing, electrically flowing from the across the junction. The simplified circuit is this one, the equivalent circuit of a solar cell. This is the simplified circuit. The internal series resistance RS here. This is the internal series resistance. This internal series resistance RS, it is mostly due to high sheet of diffuser layer. Okay, we are having some high sheet. This is having some resistance. So high sheet of diffuser layer resistance is RS. This is series with the junction. So that's why it is kept series to the junction. And the light generated acts as a constant current source, supplying the current to either junction or useful load. It is depending upon the junction characteristics, first one, and value of external load resistance also. Okay, so the light which is coming, it is acting as a constant current source, supplying the current to two junctions, or it is acting as a useful load depending upon the junction characteristics only it adds. So this value of and it also depends upon the value of external load resistance also, this RL. The net current J, it is given by capital J is equal to JL minus JI is equal to, in place of J we are getting before, J naught exponential VE by KT minus 1. So in place of J we have to substitute this value. So in place of J, J naught exponential VE by KT minus 1 is substituted. So this is the net current J given by. And there is an internal voltage drop in the cell. Actually it can be minimized. And for, suppose we are taking for ideal cell. For ideal cells, RS resistance is taken as 0. So RS is equal to 0. That means series or internal resistance can be equal to 0 in ideal cells. But this is not in practical. Okay. So with these points, above consideration of points, corresponding JV plot will be given in next figure I will show. Next slide, JV plot. So upon the considerations we are taking, the JV plot in next slide. So open circuit voltage V naught C is finally given by V naught C is equal to KT by E ln. Ln means if you take for logarithm base as E, it becomes ln. right? So ln j l minus j naught plus 1, right? This is the open circuit voltage V naught. See, if you observe this slide, this is a JV plot. It is usually for ideal solar cell which does not exist. So for ideal solar cell, actually RS, series or internal resistance, will be equal to zero. So total power, this is the maximum power point at what we are getting. This is the plot of JV plot. So J, current intensity, is taken on y axis and voltage is taken on x axis. This is the actual output voltage. So for a VMP maximum voltage, we are getting a current maximum intensity here. So upon joining this, this is the open circuit voltage V naught C. So V naught C will be equal to the slope of JMP and VMP. Okay, so this is the maximum point power. This is called as maximum power point, and it is defined as PMX, that is equal to multiplication of voltage and J, current and voltage. This is current voltage curve. This is electron energy diagram. So how the energy will be increasing? So these are the minus symbols are electrons and plus symbols represent volts. See, from EF the electron voltage will be increasing to V, increasing by V times. This is the JV plot for only ideal solar cell, not the practical solar cells. So if JI is equal to, we know that the current and voltage relationship formula, JI is equal to J naught exponential VE by KT minus 1. If that, we are assuming JL will be less than J naught. Okay, if you assume JL will be greater than J naught in equation 1, then the open circuit voltage will be changed from VOC is equal to KT by E ln JL by J naught. So actually in practice, the open circuit voltage of the cell will be decreasing with increasing in temperature. If you increase in temperature, the VOC will be decreases. It is vice versa. So the maximum power that can be derived from the device, it is given as P maximum is equal to, from the circuit only, P maximum is equal to VMP into JMP, where VMP and JMP, these are the maximum values of voltage and current. This is the maximum power at voltage and current points. So it can be seen that maximum efficiency for a cell, it is obtained by dividing the voltage and current by total power density of the sunlight, P sun. So here P sun is total power density of the sunlight. So if you divide the current and voltage and current with P sun, we will get the efficiency for the cell. So thus efficiency is equal to VMP by JMP divided by P sun. That is equal to, we can call it as, we can substitute the values, JL EG by E into P sun. Okay, so JMP VMP by JL V naught C and E into V naught C by EG. So in this, the second factor, second term is called as fill factor, and the third term is called as voltage factor, right? So in this EG, capital EG is there, where EG is equal to, it is the forbidden energy gap. It is called as forbidden energy gap. And the fill factor FF will be discussed in next slide. So this is the fill factor FF. Fill factor FF. This fill factor, it is, for a solar cell, it is defined as the ratio of two areas shown. First one is JMP VMP area, and second one is JL V0C area. So if you divide these two areas, it gets the ratio. It is called as fill factor. Actually, solar cell designers, they maximum try their effect effort to increase the fill factor values. Okay, so the one who is designing the solar cell, they will be trying to maximum level to increase the fill factor values, and they will be also trying to minimize the internal losses. The maximum power can be defined in the terms of V naught C and JL, and these are given by P maximum power. Maximum power is equal to JL into V naught C into fill factor. A typical value of fill factor for a good silicon cell, it is about 0.8, and this voltage factor, it is called as E V naught C by EZ. This is found out by the basic properties, depending upon the basic properties of the materials in the cell, and it is of order 0.5 for a silicon cell. Okay, fill factor will be 0.8 for silicon cell, and voltage factor will be 0.5 for silicon cells. So until now we are taking the solar radiations, and these are falling on the solar cell, and we are saying that we are converting them into electrical energy. But strictly speaking, for both theoretical and practical reasons, not all of the solar radiation energy falling on the solar cell, it cannot be converted into electrical energy, only some parts. The specific amount of energy, a specific amount of energy is required to produce a free electrons and a hole in the semiconductor materials, right? So this is the specific amount of energy which produces the free electrons and holes. So in silicon, if you take a silicon for example, the energy minimum is needed is 1.1 electron volts. Okay, and this is available in radiation having a wavelength of 1.1 micrometers or even less also sometimes. So these infrared radiations of longer wavelengths, these have no photovoltaic effect in silicon, but it is largely absorbed as heat. Though they are not having any effect, these are largely absorbed as heat. And even the energy of radiation with shorter wavelengths, they cannot be used completely. So if you see that long waves are not having any effect, so we think that only short waves have effect, but in those short waves also we are not using even the half of the energy of the short waves also. Okay, so these shorter wavelengths are also not completely used. Energy in excess of that needs to be free a bound electron, it is simply converted into heat. And only up to these conversations we can know that only 45% of the energy in the solar radiation at sea level, this level we are comparing at sea level, it is capable of producing electrons and holes in the silicon. Okay, so what is the percentage? 45% of energy in the solar radiation it can produce at sea level, can produce electrons and holes because of the electrical resistance of the semiconductor material. This is a loss, and other loss modes are also be there. The maximum practical efficiency for the conversion of solar energy into electrical energy in a silicon solar cell, it is estimated to be only 21% only. Okay, this is the maximum efficiency of solar energy converted into the electrical energy. What is that? Only 21%. Photovoltaic semiconductors with conversion efficiencies up to 25% or more. Examples of this are gallium arsenide. This is the correct example. So these photovoltaic semiconductors, they have a conversion efficiencies of 25%, about 25%, but it is uncertain, means it is not even uncertain. If extra conversion efficiency can compensate for additional cost, okay, so if you put any extra additional cost, only we can reach to this percentage. Okay, under if you are using under some special circumstances, only we can go up to this extent of efficiency. So what is the maximum efficiency we can go? If you put extra cost, means 25% only, that is normally we can go up to 21% in the silicon. So because of this internal losses arising from a minute amounts of impurities, okay, while forming the silicon crystal we are having some minute impurities, because of these impurities we are getting the internal losses. So internal losses will be arising because due to the minute amounts of impurities in the silicon crystal, and these internal losses are also due to recombination of electrons and holes before they get separated. And what are the extra losses? Means external losses from reflection. And most silicon solar cells have a conversion efficiency of roughly about 13 to 14%. Actually, strictly speaking, we can say only 12%, not 13 to 14. Also, we can go up to only 12%. But these cells are there is a possibility to make with efficiencies of 18% also. And this level of percentage 18 we can attain in commercial cells only. Okay, and the power output, it is usually expressed in watts. The power output in watts of a of any generator of electricity, including a photovoltaic cell, it is equal to the product of voltage and current. So silicon cell should have a voltage of 1.1 volts. From 1.1 electron volts energy of free electrons produced. Okay, in practice, however, the maximum voltage is about 0.6 volts only. And this will be, this 0.6 volts will be occurring on open circuits when no power is produced. Open circuits means when no power is produced. So the maximum power of a silicon cell occurs at an output voltage of approximately 0.45 volts. So at what voltage the maximum power power in a silicon power exists, means the output voltage of approximately 0.5 volts, the maximum power will be occurring in the silicon cells. So in if full sunlight, if there is a full sunlight, the current from a commercial cell is then roughly, what is the current value, means if it is say full sunlight, considering if we are considering full sunlight, the current from a commercial cell will be roughly 270 amperes per square meter of exposed surface. Okay, for square meter of exposed surface we are getting only 270 amperes. So the power from this current, the power is about 0.45 into 270. That means that 120 watts or 0.12 kilowatts we can say per square meter. That is 13 watts per square meter. So the power is around 120 watts per square meter or 0.12 kilowatts or 13 watts per square meter. So the rate at which the solar energy reaches the top of the atmosphere, that is the solar constant, it is 1.353 kilowatts per square meters. okay, that is 1.353 kilowatts per square meters, and part of this energy again it is reflected back into the space, and some part is reflected back into the space and some part is absorbed by the atmosphere. So if you consider a full sunlight, the solar energy may reach the ground at a rate of roughly 1 kilowatt per square meters. Okay, so the electric power output of a photovoltaic cell is roughly proportional to the rate at which solar radiation falls onto its surface only. Mainly it is proportional, the electric power we are getting as output, it is proportional to the rate at which solar radiation falls onto its surface. So the output of a cell of a given area, this can be increased by, this output can be increased by combining it with a concentrating collector. Not only individually using a photovoltaic cell, if you combine it with a concentrating collector, this gets more efficient. And tracking collection of the line focus type can provide a concentration of few hundred folds. So with the in the concentrating collectors, if you use a compound parabolic, that is non-focusing concentrator, already we discussed this concentrator in before classes in unit 2. So CPC, this is called as compound parabolic concentrator, CPC, or a concentration factor of about 10 is possible without tracking, and with tracking this concentration factor will be increasing. As these focusing collectors concentrate direct solar radiations only, okay, so we are having direct solar radiation and diffuse solar radiation, but this CPCs, only these focusing collectors concentrates only direct solar radiation, they will not constitute diffuse radiation. So as they are only concentrating on direct solar radiation, they will be most useful in regions of high insolations. Okay, so this limitation might not be applicable to the CPC since it can collect diffuse radiation. Okay, this limitation, it is not applicable to CPC because it collects scattered radiation or diffuse radiations. And most of the solar energy cannot be converted into electricity in a photovoltaic cell. Okay, so all the energy absorbed is not converted into heat. In commercial single crystal, if you use a single crystal silicon cell, for example, it is having a conversion efficiency of about 12%. More than 80% of the incident solar energy appears as a heat in the cell. Okay, so out of 100%, more than 80% will be appearing as a heat in the cell. As the temperature increases, the efficiency of NP homojunction silicon cell will be decreasing. For example, if you take a for a commercial cell, it is about 8% at 100 degrees Celsius. Okay, so if cells are made of gallium arsenide, because these gallium arsenide are very superior to the silicon cells, because at the operations of elevated temperatures, these work more efficiently, these gallium arsenide. So if gallium arsenide are compensated with the silicon cells, their higher cost may be justified when used with concentrating collectors only. Okay, so if you use these higher costly cells, these must be used in the combination of only concentrating collectors only we have to use in combination, because this cost will be compensated in the output what we are getting. So the conversion efficiency of a practical gallium arsenide solar cell is roughly about 18% of at the ordinary temperatures. And if you increase the temperature to 100 degrees Celsius, we are getting the percentage of 16. So, and if you increase the temperature to 200 degrees Celsius, the percentage of efficiency will be decreasing to 12. So, as we discussed below, if the temperature increases, the conversion efficiency will be decreasing. At room temperature, 18. Room temperature means it will be around 32 degrees Celsius. Okay, so at 32, we are getting 18%. At 100 degrees, efficiency will be, the conversion efficiency will be decreasing to 16. At 200, it is again decreasing by 12. Okay, so this gallium arsenide is a good absorber of solar radiation. And NP homojunction can be made from thin films of polycrystalline material. For this gallium arsenide, the NP homojunction, it can be formed from thin films of polycrystalline material. And high conversion efficiencies with concentrating collectors have been developed in the cells with a combination of this gallium aluminium and gallium arsenides. Okay, so what we are discussing before, conversion efficiencies can be improved if you use the combination of gallium aluminium and gallium arsenide. This is a basic photovoltaic system for power generation. It is integrated with a utility grid. It is shown in this figure. This is the integration of utility grid. It permits solar generated electrical power to a delivery load. So what load we have to deliver? This solar photovoltaic system